I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. Eight to they fool. Run through the night, playing with your life. Going against the pack, that's risking your life. Better play it right. Yeah, you better play it right.
All right, folks, we're back with another edition of the Red and White Podcast. I'm your host, Evan, here with Will, as always. Man, it's been a week. We're late getting this podcast out. Things happen. There's been a lot to talk about, a lot of dust settling. We've got to get into, and we got to get it out of the way. I know everybody's probably tired of talking about it, and I kind of am too. I just kind of want it to be on, but it is something we need to talk about, the whole MJ Morris situation. I'm going to play these couple of clips, Will, before we get into it and before we get our thoughts on it. Because the national media, who is not as close to what's been going on, has put some thoughts out about it. And I always find it interesting to hear their perspective, especially when we're talking about, you know, they're not paying attention to family tweeting and, you know, those things we're hearing from inside the program. They're not
out.
Close. Yeah. So I'm going to play these couple of clips, we'll take a break in between them because one of them is pretty long. I'm going to start with the Cover 3 pod, and this was on Tuesday or Wednesday.
Quickie here before we hit the break. Didn't get a chance, Bud, to chat with you on this. What's your read on the MJ Morris situation at NC State? For those who are a little bit late to the take on this one, the NC State quarterback who took over for Brennan Armstrong is 3-1 as a starter. He is coming off back-to-back wins against Clemson and Miami, and it was announced this week that he will be redshirting the rest of the season. Brennan Armstrong takes over as the starting quarterback for the Wolfpack once again. I believe Alex Thomas, I think is our other scholarship quarterback. Kind of a thin room if something were to happen to Brennan Armstrong the rest of the way. You know, for context, Dave Doran did indicate near the beginning of the season on a coach's show that the plan, you know, was for MJ Morris to redshirt the entire year, continue to develop, and let Brennan Armstrong be a little bit of a bridge quarterback before Morris takes over as a full-time starter. But your break glass in case of emergency quarterback, you needed to break the glass to be able to save the season. He's done that. They've reached bowl eligibility. There's other NIL potential factors here. What's your read on this situation?
So I don't have insider info here. I'm just trying to craft something that makes some sense. It makes perfect sense that maybe they told MJ Morris and family, hey, we're bringing in Brennan Armstrong. We would still like you to play four games because you can do so and preserve your red shirt. I believe you can play the bowl game now too, right? Or at least you could last year. So I would assume that rule would hold over again, but I haven't seen so. So, you know, his four games are up. There's probably some kind of compromise like, hey, please don't transfer despite the fact that we're taking Brennan Armstrong. We'd still like to use you for four games. You know, I don't know that Morris is like some big time NFL prospect, but he's a talented enough, not to say good enough, because I don't think he's actually good yet, but like talented enough, physically talent, to where he can make some NIL money. So it gives him another year to make NIL money and potentially helps him out to get more playing time down the line. Like, this is just a balance of roster. NC State is not the type of program that can go out and take a fairly proven-ish quarterback like Brennan Armstrong and expect not to piss off their nice recruiting win second-year player named MJ Morris. So this is probably something Doran had to handle before the season, right? Like, if you're Alabama, you can get away with that, kind of. If you're NC State, you can't. Mm-hmm. Delicate things need to be managed.
What do y'all think?
I think, or do I want the conspiracy?
Both.
All right. What do I think is he planned a red shirt this year? They're thinking of 2024 as a year where MJ gets, you know, comes in, they're about stronger. And because this year they're not winning the ACC. Tinfoil hat. This saves a year of eligibility for when MJ Morris transfers to wherever Dave Doran is coaching next year, be it at Michigan State or somewhere else.
Terrible take.
So has Dave Doran spoken on this yet?
Not. Let's see. His availability was Monday. I don't think so. And look,
I'm curious to see what he says. Like, so you think this is a managed situation where Dave Doran's okay with it? because there's public backlash at MJ Morris, which I understand, but I think you also have to look at it from the player's perspective of he had, you know, last year he played really well, looked like he was going to get his big opportunity this year. And then all of a sudden, boom, Brandon Armstrong comes in. It's like, what the heck? And they tell him, we're going to redshirt you this year. Don't worry about it. Give you a year of development, your team the next year. Then he comes in, burns that one, doesn't play great. Maybe he's just mad at the way everything has unfolded. Like that was kind of my read on potentially if he does transfer out, if he leaves NC State, totally could understand it. Even though a lot of people are like, how do you do this? You're 3-1. How would you leave your team back in the dust? This is a new era of player who does not think about the best of the team. Most of them are thinking what's best for me. Like, what do I need to do to best make it to the NFL, to get the biggest NIL deal, whatever it is. So I don't know. I'm just looking at every possibility that could be happening.
Because they did put Brennan Armstrong back in that game. That was my other thought, Danny. Yeah, like, is he pissed off that, like, maybe there's some, hey, I'm willing to burn this red shirt if it's me the rest of the way and we're riding with me.
Right.
But I'm not doing this Steve Spurrier-esque musical chairs quarterback thing. So just redshirt me and I'll take the full season or I'll take the road out of town.
So he hasn't left the team. He is at practice. He's just working. Yeah, he's working with the scout team. You know, if you were 100% out, you would be out. His father told WRAL, you know, he never said he was going to transfer. If he wanted to transfer, he could have done it in December. He could have done it in May. You know, this clearly there's something to this. I don't know. I'm sitting there, Danny, thinking about the locker room, and that was one thing that I was you know, texting with a friend who's a little bit more in the know on the program. I was like, how do you go back into that locker room when you were the part of the turnaround? And that's going to be something that's difficult potentially to manage, or everybody knew that this was the case from the very beginning. Here's what's significant in terms of MJ Morris and the 2024 Wolfpack. The best offensive player for NC State, by my read, is the freshman wide receiver, Casey Concepcion. They don't have a ton of dynamic skill players beyond Casey, but they do have a four-star running back named Jonathan Paylor, who is extremely talented and is sort of like looked at as like, this is the kind of, you know, highly recruited skill player
that
NC State does not always, does not traditionally get, you know, one of the finest players in the state of North Carolina. When you're able to go and win that battle and get somebody there, now you're starting to spin this forward with, all right, MJ, look at the offense around you. You do not have a lot. But if KC comes back with another year of development, we bring in Jonathan Paylor, we go portal shopping and try to do a better job of our evaluation of trying to bring in guys that can help you, you are going to have a better chance for success next season. You know, let's all invest in this together.
Everybody gets adrift of that one.
I can see that. I think it stinks because you know who's left on NC State schedule?
It's certainly
games
a take.
That matter to fans.
Yeah.
Wait, right, did you, coming up
I get
this
it, right? If I'm thinking about it from the outside standpoint, I get it. Like, it looks like
games that,
you know, Dave saving his quarterback bit, to go with him wherever he wants to go. So like, we'll,
that's what you can say.
That's a crazy thing.
NC State fan,
it is, but I get it, right? If you didn't know any better, you can see it happening, right? Everybody's like talking about these jobs opening. He's a good fit for it. And his name's been mentioned a few times. Like, they don't really know. Like, he's not going anywhere. But I can see it. You know, I can understand where that take came from. I thought it was funny.
Did you hear the Yahoo podcast?
I have that one too.
Today. Okay. Yeah, let me just say real quick. Yeah, I thought I just thought that's crazy. It's like, Tom's take is the worst one because if anything, he's retiring. So that was just
I wouldn't expect the national guy to know that, though.
It's just so funny because there's like three of them that are relatively local with how they know way more about NC State than most national podcasts. So that's
correct.
I was just surprised he said that, but I like the idea. I mean, it is kind of a funny concept, but then when you think about what's happened here, it's like there's no effing way in the world Dave Dorn would want MJ Morris with him at the next stop.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense. I'll play the Yahoo one, too. It's not nearly as long.
All right. Interesting story. North Carolina State. How about this one? Here's a conundrum for you. So they got a kid named MJ Morris. He's their quarterback. Last year, he's a freshman. He starts three games in November for NC State. You figure he's going to be the starter as a sophomore. However, North Carolina State goes out and grabs Virginia's Brennan Armstrong in the transfer portal to, you know, help compete. Camp last summer, Armstrong beats Morris out for the starting job. Probably a bad call. Seemingly a bad call. Armstrong struggles. 4 weeks ago, or 4 games ago, NC State switches quarterbacks, goes with MJ Morris. He now assumes the starting job. Throws 648 passes, 7 touchdowns, 1 interception in 4 games. More importantly, they win 3 of the 4 games, including beating Clemson and beating Miami. MJ Morris is now settled in. He is the starter. Things are rolling. NC State is 6-3 on the season. And this week, it's announced that MJ Morris is redshirting. You can play 4 games in college football and preserve your redshirt. So this year won't count. He saves an entire year of eligibility unless he takes 1 more snap. So he is not going to play again this year to preserve an entire season. His father told the AP and other media that MJ would stay with the program. He was not necessarily going right into the portal, but we do know there is a transfer portal out there. There are NIL deals at other schools. Could be an NIL deal at North Carolina State to stay and remain. Pretty wild. New one. What are your thoughts on this, Pat?
Oh, it's fascinating and very much a sign of the times here. I sympathize with MJ Morris in this situation because they went to the portal to get somebody to take his job. He can hit the portal to leave when he chooses, and this could be the time he chooses because of the redshirt rule. So, yeah, he may say he's going to stay through the rest of the season. Clearly, you're not doing this if you're planning on staying there. And I think that probably this does reflect some real displeasure about the way that was handled, especially it would be one thing if Brennan Armstrong had come in and just clearly proven to be a superior quarterback who had done great things and had led NC State, you know, to a great success. I think you probably just tip your cap and say, okay, but he didn't play very well. And now MJ Morris has played marginally better. It's not like he's lit the world on fire passing-wise, just his statistics, but he's gotten them to wins. Mostly their defense, I think, has, holding Miami to 6 and Clemson to 17. But I don't blame him. He's got the cards. Play him as you see fit for yourself at this point. You know, from a team dynamic standpoint, it's shaky, it's ugly, but, you know, NC State said business is business, and now MJ Morris is saying business is business.
Yeah, we all ought to be prepared for more of this. I think we've seen it a little bit last season. I think we saw a few times, but maybe not something like this where you have a starting quarterback do this. Like I figured we might have had a couple of receivers, like a DB or two last year, do this.
I think there's a kid at Boise this year.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's here and there. We've seen it, and it's only going to get more prevalent. And yeah, I mean, this is athletes looking out for themselves, and there shouldn't be a problem with that. I mean, I know coaches are not going to like it, administrators are not going to like it, but this is the kind of the movement, the athletes' rights movement we're in the middle of, and these rule changes, which give athletes more freedom, which is probably most would say is fair, allows things like this to happen. And but I kind of feel just a tinge bad for NC State. I mean, they lost Devin Leary last year to Kentucky. It's like, to be, you know, what's wrong with Raleigh? Is it that bad? Come on.
That real quick, they're not the same dynamics, but a similar sort of, am I redshirting or not? Tension at Michigan State this week. Sam Levitt, who had
so they go on to Michigan State again. And played pretty too many well. Parallels.
Can I just give that like,
was a, it's a different take. I mean, it's a different opinion.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, again, I'm sure we're going to talk about it, or I'll bring it up multiple times. If MJ Morris had to play the UVA game and the UL game behind this line, considering how many more sacks he takes right now than Brennan Armstrong was, we would have lost those games. It would have been way worse. This MJ Morris season would have been awful. So, like, honestly, like, the best thing in the world happened with him with the defense playing lights out. Special teams was lights out during that sequence. And he got the benefit of the doubt. I hope it helps him in the transfer portal. There's no way in hell this guy plays for State again.
Yeah, I mean, that's
so
my
funny
general...
just listening to the national view of it, right? Because they're just not close enough to know. But it's like you hear him say a couple things there, and you're like, man, like someone said it. Like, yeah, the defense was really doing the work.
Yeah.
And if they just listed out his stats, like someone said 600 yards and whatever, it's like, okay, but then that, you look at it and you're like, oh, it was like 110 yards a game, 120 yards a game. Doesn't look nearly as good. So, again, I don't know. It's just frustrating because, like, that's the one area where a little bit of a cohesive message early in the week would have had national podcasts kind of saying, okay, well, here's why this happened, right? I think having to wait till Thursday for Dave to give his input, which I thought was very refreshing and clarifying.
Here's what Dave said.
Bam, man. It's like...
Actually, I did some homework this week.
As you guys know, MJ has chosen to redshirt, and Brennan Armstrong is our starter. And I didn't announce that on Monday. I was hoping we could maintain a competitive advantage in our preparation with Wake Forest having to prepare, as you've seen, with two quarterbacks on the field at the same time. That plan didn't work, okay? Somebody found out, put it out there on Tuesday, is what it is. But as I told you guys previously in one of my press conferences earlier in the season, I think it was after our VMI game, our plan was, beginning of the year, to try and redshirt MJ, and that was the plan. And to give him a chance behind an experienced quarterback to develop and grow. And as the season unfolded and we struggled offensively, I felt it was time to reassess that plan. And that's part of my job. And the team needed a spark. So I met with MJ, Coach Roper, and I, and asked him if he wanted to play, because I thought he could help our offense and our team, and he agreed, and we pushed forward with that plan in place of him playing. And as games progressed and time went on, MJ came to me and let me know that he was still thinking about preserving his redshirt. I was surprised, you know, by that, because he was our starter and really didn't expect that, you know, for a starting player to want to sit back down. He said he wasn't sure which way to go, but he wanted me to know that that was something that he was thinking about and talking with his family about. After the fourth game, he was very decisive and telling me it was important to him and his family to preserve his red shirt. And so we're honoring that decision. And with that, Brennan is our starter. Our team has embraced him in this role, and we're rallying around him and super excited to see what he does in this opportunity. With his finish, he's handled this, as Aiden said yesterday, like a grown-ass man.
That's about what I expected Dave to say. I think there's probably partial truth in there, but he's going to take the high road 100% of the time.
What do you think he's hedging or kind of covering?
I think he's, you know, alluding to they didn't, you know, they were planning on playing two quarterbacks or they wanted Wake to prepare for two quarterbacks, like probably partly true there. Like, I think they obviously wanted that. Also that he alluded to the plan to redshirt MJ and that they were going to stick to this plan. And then MJ just said he wanted a redshirt. You know, I don't think it went down like that, but I don't expect Dave to say anything else.
Oh, I think he's giving like incredible air cover for MJ Morris and his family currently. You know what I mean? I do believe he obviously wanted that competitive advantage of them not knowing we're going to go primary to Brennan. Yeah. I would say he still has a little bit of an element surprise in no one's seen Brennan run MJ's offense. And God, I hope they do that. I'm going to lose my mind if we revert back to what we were doing, yeah. Brennan, that would be crazy at this point. But I think he did MJ Morrison immense solid, because he could have trashed the hell out of his parents and him for making the decision. Like, it's crazy. I was listening to IPS earlier and James kind of nailed it. It's like he had the potential to play 8 games this season. Like, it's not like his camp is trying to phrase it as, well, we didn't want to play a partial season again, but it's like 8 games is a lot, and you could have possibly led the team to a historic season of 10 wins. So, like, I don't know. The whiskey's starting to talk. Before.
Yeah, I've said this before in about 100 different circumstances, but there's 3 sides to every story.
For sure.
I don't believe anything that anybody's saying in this situation. It'll come out eventually at the end of the year when it's all said and done, when MJ hits the portal. And yeah, like none of it makes any sense. That's the crazy part. It's like, I get what they're saying about selfish players and whatnot, but yeah, he's going to have most of a season to play. Maybe he was butthurt that they brought in Brennan Armstrong. Okay, get over it, right?
Yeah,
it's part of growing up. Yeah, win the job, play better. He hasn't played good. And yeah, you're not going to go anywhere. I'm going to be curious where he ends up, right? Because he's a starting quarterback at a Power 5 program who is in the top third of the conference, had a chance to, you know, make the conference championship game. And where are you going to go? Like, you're going up? I don't think so. He's going down. Like, that's the only thing I can think of. And maybe it's just, you know, I'm not going to play in the NFL. I'm going to get my bag now. Maybe. Seems strange. You know, the whole thing seems strange.
The highest recommendation I could give to him is go somewhere that's got a great offensive line and great run game. And because so far what we've seen, his ability to process the field, it's not been great.
He needs some serious coaching.
He holds onto the ball for way too long.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, like, here's the thing, right? You could flip it that way and say, like, hey, you know, didn't have the skill around me. He could be fine elsewhere. I don't know how any team would be like, oh, you decided to think just of yourself for the last 3 games or 4 games. That guy can never be the quarterback of that team again. It's crazy. Now, I mean, if he came to them and was like, hey, you know what? I just really haven't been playing that well. I think I really need more time, and Brennan can lead this team. You know, if he had just said, I'll be there in case of injury, you know what I mean? Like, it would be a different story. And maybe that conversation was had, but, like, all I can think about is, like, Brennan Armstrong goes to Wake, somehow gets injured, we win the game, and then they're sitting there, and MJ goes, well, I'm not going to burn my red shirt to help you out. Like, that's when you might as well pack your bags and get the fuck out of there. Like, that's when you'll know the truth of the matter, I guess.
What would happen if MJ doesn't transfer? And maybe in the story, I don't know, maybe the parents are less involved than we're hearing, right? He really wants to just play a whole year. He wants to get better, and he's still here next year.
What would happen? We'd still bring in a transfer quarterback. You'd have this happen again. Maybe he'd win the job the second time around, right? Like, there's skills there. The question really is like, are we doing what we need to do to make him better, right? I mean, here's my hope is that, like, Dino Babers gets canned at the end of the season. Jason Beck becomes available. We bring him in. He helps coach the quarterbacks. Is Roper coaching the quarterbacks right now, or is he doing running backs?
I think he's still quarterback because Dave referenced him a few times.
Yeah. Well, my hope is some changes are made in that department too. I'd love to have him just like in a supporting role and not an assistant role. But it's going to be the same story.
And that's what all the guys are missing when they're saying, like, bringing in Brennan Armstrong. They're, like, painting it like we were not that we were crazy, but, like, well, you brought in Brennan Armstrong. What did you think would happen? It's like, well, did you know that there was no other starting quarterback on the team? You had a walk-on in Lex Thomas. So, of course, you're going to go bring in a portal quarterback. And you should, at all times, bring in the best possible quarterback you can.
Absolutely.
We just got burned with the Jack Chambers move. And no one's talking about it. They'd have a different opinion if they were, remember, he got injured. And then he decided not to play the bowl game. Like, you get a couple more details, and all of a sudden the picture becomes a little bit different now. Oh, was he flirting with going to Auburn? Oh, okay, the picture's a little different now.
Yeah.
Right? Like, just a couple more details. That's where I would have thought that the Cover 3 guys, I thought, would have picked up on that. Maybe they were trying to not blow anything, but I don't know.
I don't know how in tune they are, or, you know, what they're thinking, you know, how much they're thinking about it, right? They're just not paying that close of attention.
Yeah. Did they bet on us? That's all I want to know.
Yeah, they all bet to cover 6.5 wins for the year. Everyone
else. Nice. Yeah. And they're going to be proven right.
The thought that I keep coming back to, thinking about this over the last few days, the damn quarterback position at NC State has been handled atrociously over the last 5 seasons, essentially since Jacoby left.
Run us through
right?
it.
Right? I mean, the whole Hockman-Leary thing, the Jack Chambers coming in, and then this situation. It's been like, if I'm Dave and I am still sticking around and I am doing this, I am looking hard at who is responsible for, one, my roster, but two, the quarterback position, because it has been poorly recruited and mishandled.
Okay. I've got a good counterpoint.
Okay.
Okay. Post-Jacoby, you brought in Ryan Finley.
Oh, who, I got them backwards. Whatever. Post-Finley, then.
No. But what I'm saying, right, is so Drinkwitz brings in Finley. Drinkwitz recruits Leary, leaves. We're left with whatever just happened with Des Kitchings and George McDonald. Hockman comes in as a transfer. That COVID season plays out, right? Leary gets injured. Then you bring in Beck, or Beck was there for the COVID year, right? Right. So then you get another person's philosophy. So you bring in their quarterbacks. Then Beck leaves, then you bring in Anai. So you've got another person's philosophy. So it kind of makes sense when you think about it, right? Like 4 OCs and in this tenure, it makes sense that you've got kind of like an erratic quarterback room. Plus, guys left. Guys never got here. Evans, McLaughlin. I feel like there's one more. And then you also took a quarterback in the last class that's, I mean, who knows what's going to happen with Lex Thomas. Maybe that's like the greatest gamble that pays off. But to me, it kind of makes sense. It's like, okay, you had all this disruption. Then you bring in Brennan Armstrong, which I think we all thought going into the season, it was kind of the best choice, really. Like, who? Haynes King wasn't an option for us. Like, not that we could get him. It's just that he wasn't someone we were considering. I can't really recall anyone else that we thought would have been a good choice that we didn't pursue. Like McCall, but wasn't that like an academics issue?
I don't know.
Class credits or something?
Yeah.
So,
but even so, your point's right. And I agree. Like, Armstrong was a calculated risk because you're hoping you get him back with an eye and it comes back to 2021 Brennan Armstrong, right? Everybody, that's what the hope was. Didn't work out, but it was a risk and it was a calculated risk. I get it.
There was a second hope there, though, right? That all of the skill players in the offensive linemen that you've been recruiting that you were banking on being better did not get better, right? So it was like the worst possible outcome where you get Brennan Armstrong, but you have no one to help him really yet.
Yeah.
Now yeah. Pause.
I mean, they addressed the offensive line with 2J.
Right.
But they didn't address enough with portal talent. We've talked about that already.
Yeah.
I mean, more from the who's going to play, who's not going to play, right? I just feel like that was the whole. I feel it's just been a roller coaster. There's been no consistency for whatever reason. And I know there's more reasons than, you know, just playing, just who's playing well and who's not playing well, and what we see on the field, right? I mean, it was the same thing with MJ, and Dave came out last year and said, "Hey, you don't know what you got until you get him under the lights," right? And he played okay in those games, but it just feels like it's just been. If there was more consistency at that position over the last 5 years, I think the results would have been even better than, you know, everybody's been happy where they are, but I think the results would have been better.
I think that Jack Chambers one is the one that's easiest to point out as like, that was a terrible idea. But at the same time, you were supposed to have a quote unquote Heisman quarterback candidate, right?
Yeah.
So who's coming to sit behind him?
Right. No, again, calculated risk.
Right. But at the same time, right? Like, we could also argue you never set that guy up to be successful either. He was running very different offenses, and then you weren't calling those kind of plays to support him. So I don't know. Yeah. Again, I just think it was kind of like we didn't quite know what we were doing. We hoped we never even had to see any of these guys. And then of course we end up having to see them. Like, I don't know.
A lot of mismanagement. A lot of mismanagement.
But the more it's played out, the more I'm convinced. Like, I just really think we should have just let Brennan roll into the Marshall game and seen what happened. It's almost actually, if that game had just been at Marshall, I think it would have been better. I don't think they would have played MJ at Marshall. The fans wouldn't have been there to possibly boo him. You go and win that game. I keep looking back at the Duke game and thinking, like, God, the veteran quarterback could have won that game. Like, well, I didn't see anything from Duke that really scared me, really, on defense. It was just we were so out of sorts on offense. And that's like now that you've won these other games, right? That's going to come back to haunt you. Obviously, UVA got screwed last night. Jesus. And right? And so Charlotte's out of the question. But I don't know. I just keep coming back to him. Like, the quarterback was not really a factor in any of these games, except that they said don't throw an interception, basically. And I really hope we get to see Brennan with MJ's offense, because I feel like he's gonna do pretty, like, he'll replicate it, and I think he'll be better marginally, but it'll like look immeasurable, like the difference, I guess.
It's going to be, yeah. I mean, it's not going to rehash the whole Brandon Armstrong playing, not playing argument. It's more interesting is what they're going to do with the offense.
Yeah.
I hope they continue with what they were doing or what they have done. And Dave has made some points over the last, you know, couple weeks about, you know, we had to make some adjustments that we need to get the ball into other guys' hands. We need to stop standing over the line so much and waiting for everybody to understand the play. You know, so they made some adjustments that they didn't make when Brennan was the quarterback. So I hope that they continue with those adjustments and not just say, all right, well, Brennan knows this system that Anai wants to run, and they go back to it. Like, that doesn't make any sense. Like, that would, if that happens, then just fire everybody, because that is just incompetence, right? That shouldn't happen. I don't think it will. That's the storyline to me, is what do they ask Brennan to do? Because we've seen, you know, you don't need to have, and this is the realization for me, and I don't remember if it was in the pod chat this morning, you were talking about sustained drives. Yeah, mm-hmm. It was when I was leaving.
Yeah, and you were fired up.
Well, you guys are talking about sustained drives, and I'm like, why? What have we learned over the last 4 weeks is that this defense is really good, like really good. And the whole point of, you know, ball control, the Dorn way of wanting to sustain drives and, you know, plot it down the field is not as effective as, hey, let's see if we can score really fast and not have to plot it down the field, because the offensive line's not good enough. The quarterbacks aren't good enough. The wide receivers are barely good enough. And, you know, there's a lot of meh there. And, like, sustaining drives takes a lot more consistency and a lot better talent. And that's why I'm like, why are we worried about sustained drives? Just score as fast as possible. Get the ball to KC. Do some funky stuff. Let the man go. And that's what we've seen over the last few weeks. It doesn't matter how bad MJ has played. They've been able to score when they needed to. Obviously, it's not pretty. I get it. And they haven't put up a ton of points. But that's, they've done enough. Okay.
That's where I would counter, right? And when I say sustained drives, I'm not necessarily saying, oh, we need to have like 12 play drives, but we need to have less three and outs. And
yes,
you know, agreed. The point is the defense set the team. So like, I'll go back to the Clemson game, which I think is a really good one. There was a point in that game, right, where you could see us literally drive to drive to drive, losing the field position battle. And they were getting closer and closer and closer. And then they finally, Clemson, linked up and hit multi-play drives or multi-down drives, right? And then they scored. And so my thing is, Brennan Armstrong moves the chains at least a couple times, usually. And so that will help us reposition. So even if we're not, you know, as we're waiting for the boom, boom, bust to hit the bust sequence, I think that Brennan Armstrong and his ability to run the ball is going to extend those drives. Maybe it's only one set of downs extra, right? But that's enough to give us a little bit more time, a little bit more field position so that we can control the game and then kind of put that vice grip back on the other team and get those points. And like, and you know, kind of to your point, right, is we weren't really scoring that much, right? Like, look at the final scores for the Clemson game and the Miami game, right? It wasn't exactly like what you're hoping for in the just go score and make it easy, you know? So I think, that's what I'm coming from is I just think the offense will look a little bit more efficient. And honestly, like, I feel like people were kind of joking about it, but if you go look at like IPS's little cut up of like Brennan's passes for the season or his top passes, like if you do that for MJ, it's not going to be very many of them. And so I do think there's still some arm talent there. He can at least get to a second read. And I don't think you have to make it complicated. So that's why I keep thinking, like, this guy should be able to run what we just did very efficiently and hit guys. And, yeah, he's going to throw a couple in the dirt. It's Brennan Armstrong. He's, like, not incredibly talented as a passer. But he's also not a dog. And it's so weird that people are going to act like the second he like completes like a 20-yard pass, they're going to be like, wow, oh my God. And it's like,
the guy was
throwing it down the field beforehand. Like, that's my whole thing. It's like, MJ was very concentrated in what he could do or what they were asking him to do. And he was also missing things within that spectrum. So I just think the offense is going to be better. I also like, I don't think Wake is incredible on defense, and it's going to be a weird road game. I'm sure they're not going to make it difficult on him, but I really do think the offense is going to look smoother if they keep doing what they did and just let him have the pop passes, let him leverage KC, let him run. And like, I don't think it's going to be a crazy, like, I think like we're going to get like 28 points max kind of game. Like, it's, I feel like some people are out there like, we're going to about to hang like 45 and Wake. And if we do that, it's awesome. But
no chance. Like,
it's probably because of multiple pick sixes.
Yeah. Right. The defense. We're going to need the defense to score, as Dave has said previously. What?
Yeah.
All right. Let's move on to Wake.
No.
I really don't want to talk about MJ anymore.
Oh, I just want to talk about not Wake. I just, anything
Wake
else.
Stinks. But Winston-Salem, as everybody knows, has been a house of horrors for NC State. The last quarterback, the only quarterback to win in Winston for NC State was Jacoby Brissett. And I put that out there the other day. And I got some comments today. It was funny. I was on the golf course and people were like, dude, somebody sent me this this list of quarterbacks who hadn't won in Winston-Salem. It was crazy. And I was like, yeah, that was our list. It's like, oh, I didn't realize that was y'all.
You should be like, you don't follow us?
Yeah, respect to the pod chat for putting that one together. Yeah. Wake stinks. All right, I'm going to say it again. Wake is, they're not good. They don't know what they have at quarterback. They are turnover prone. And just the defense should be able to win this game. Brennan Armstrong, Lex Thomas, you. I mean, put anybody in there, and I think the defense is good enough against Wake to, that they should win this game. But I know Winston-Salem. All right, there's a Winston-Salem caveat for whatever reason. What have you seen in Wake? Yeah.
Yeah, I was trying to watch the Duke game before we got on here just to kind of see the best of Mitch Griffiths. That because that's what I'm more concerned with, is if the Wake Forest offense all of a sudden comes alive. That's always just been – it's just been an annoying offense. It just does not look like it did under Sam Hartman. The receivers don't quite look the same and things like that, but – yeah, I mean, it just seems like it's kind of like a solid defense. Nothing really incredible. I think they're good on third downs, possibly, but I'd have to go back and look at Wake's schedule. I mean, well, whatever. We'll see. You know, it's just weird. You know, Mitch Griffiths put together a good performance, but he was also going against Duke's third string quarterback. So at least we have one string over that. And their offensive line is very questionable. I think we're going to get a lot of pressure. I think it just really comes down to is Mitch Griffiths going to be accurate for the day, or is he going to get rattled? You know, they had a little bit of extra time to prepare for us, but they were probably thinking of MJ, and then this happened. So I don't know, man. It's really hard to look at their field goal kicker. Their kicker looked really bad against Duke. So
yeah,
that's a benefit for us, right? That, you know, even if we get put in some short field positions, at least it's not like an automatic three like it seemed like they had for years with all their kickers. So I don't know.
Wake is fifth in the league in point giving up points per game defense, like fifth worst, 10th worst.
How many? They're
fifth from the bottom. I don't know how you frame that. They're terrible. Behind Virginia, Georgia Tech, Pitt, Boston College. They are 13th on offense in points per game. So they're not scoring, and they're not stopping you from scoring. It's a bad
combination. Are we behind them?
No, we're not behind them either. Surprisingly, we're ahead of them in offense.
Okay, I'm just making sure.
Yeah, I think that Marshall game might skew that one a little bit, but yeah, we're ahead of them in both, both characters. Yeah, Marshall and VMI might skew that a little bit. But yeah, like they're just not a very good team. Trying to look at some of these other stacks. They give up the most sacks. Good gracious. They've given up 40 sacks this year.
Yeah. Now, I mean, I don't know. If you go back and watch like the Florida State game that they had a few weeks ago, it was insane to watch. Like when Mitch Griffiths is bad, he is getting hammered. He's getting sacked. He looks lost. And like, I feel like we can do that.
Yeah.
Like, that's the thing. Is like, this is not the Wake Forest team you know. It's maybe a little bit better defense, but it's really regressed on offense. And it was really until this Duke game where anyone was even talking about their offense. And yeah, he was efficient. It really looked. I mean, there was a couple times where Duke just made like really uncharacteristic busts that really put them in a spot. And then again, I haven't finished the fourth quarter, so maybe once I get to that, I'm going to be like, oh, there he is. It's just going to be another game. Defense, go out and do everything you can to win the game. Let the offense go ride the laurels of your work, and like just get the fuck out of there with a win. I don't care. Like, if we win 2-0, I'll be happy. I don't care.
Looking at the stats here, they average 205 yards per game offensively, which is actually ahead of us, which is sad.
Thanks a lot.
And defensively, yeah. So and this is weird. So we got Wake, Carolina, and Virginia Tech left, and Wake is near the bottom in offense, and they are near the bottom in defense. Carolina is the top in offense, and they are the second worst in the league in yards per game.
Oh yeah, I can't.
Only ahead of Syracuse. That's crazy. Like
if Brennan Armstrong is alive at that point, he's going to look like a Ferrari running through that defense.
Yeah.
But I will say that's the one thing is what's going to be really interesting with the Brennan Armstrong experience is do we ever bring any more tempo back into it? And the only reason I bring that up is UNC's defense, when you start going tempo on them, like you can see it, like as the game goes on, they just like crater off. And so I think it was the second quarter and the fourth quarter for Georgia Tech. This is like a perfect example, right? You're going up into halftime and they smash them in the second quarter, come out of halftime after a little bit of break, right? A little bit better. Like they hold, I think Georgia Tech had no points basically in that sequence. And then they let up 250 yards in the fourth. And so it'll be really curious do we just lean in and say, I don't know how long we're going to have Brennan Armstrong. Do we just say like, let's go for it. Let's gas the engine up. Let's keep it simple, but run it fast. I mean, really curious to see. So I think that's something you see VT and UNC. I think we're going to keep it stupid simple this week. I hope so.
I think we should. NC State is dead last in the ACC in offensive efficiency, so surprising nobody there. But Wake is only two spots ahead of us. So
that's my point, right? Is when you're so inefficient, even a little efficiency is going to look incredible. You're going to be like, wow, did we just get two first downs? You know, it's going to be a big difference maker. And honestly, like the thing I've been worried about the last few weeks is the defense can only play lights out for so long, right? Like at some point, someone's going to break through. Miami was really close on a couple of runs, for example, or like screen passes. And someone's going to get through on us. And then you're going to have a competent offense to come back and really win the game. Like we've been front runners for three of the last four games, I think.
Yeah, I think you're exactly right. State's got to get ahead, and they got to get ahead and let the defense play aggressive and do what the defense does. If they're chasing points, was a bad spot for us. So State needs to get out early and score, and Wake lets a lot of people score. So I just expect this to be, for lack of a better term, another rock fight, just because that's how we've been playing games.
And it won't.
You don't think?
No. This is I know it's because I'm like really deep into a heavy pour of whiskey right now, but this is the Ant Smith game. We got that intel from one of our guys who saw it in person. This is the Ant Smith game. Brennan Armstrong and Ant Smith have a connection. It's happening, dude. Think about it, right? He's been getting second team reps the whole time. Who does he get to work with when it's second team? Terrell Timmons and Ant Smith. Here it's coming, guys. I'm telling you. Robert and I is going to say, you know what, Dave? I think we should play the two fast guys. And they're going to do it. And it's going to get lit. I'm telling you.
But then that was not one of your better Anai impressions.
It's hard, man. It's really hard. This Woodford Rye has hit me hard.
All right, let's get into some of these questions because we got a ton. Where did your alias name come from?
We're not ready for that. What's the story? That's off season.
Oh,
that's off season.
Okay.
Now that's when we really need to fill the airwaves.
Okay. How many remaining games will State win with Armstrong at quarterback?
Four.
If they win four, if they win three, and we know we're not, Dave doesn't really care about bowl games.
He'll care about this one.
Because it'll be his last. If they win four.
No, I meant because it'll be not just his last, but it'll be for 10, right? And he's so butt puckered over that UCLA game still.
Yeah. If they win the last four games, and after dealing with all this stuff that he's been dealing with this week alone, right? Yeah, I know we talked about this in the last podcast. You think, have you changed your mind that he's had enough? Like, there's a lot of BS, right? That was a bigger...
I was going to answer that a completely different way. When I said retire, I was going to say retire Brennan Armstrong's jersey.
Oh.
Ring of Honor, for sure. But, if that happens, Dave's, like, sailing off. I can't imagine he wants to deal with that again. But then, I don't know. if I'm that competitive, right, and I'm like, this was not even one of my best years, and I just got 10 wins, and I had to deal with an asshole betraying me middle of the season.
Who's going to be my quarterback at Michigan State.
And actually, yeah, and who that's who I want to start. It's going to be so funny if they just keep playing this game of chicken and he just stays on the roster. It's going to be amazing. I can't actually – I just can't wait. Yeah, I mean, I think he might retire at that point. Like, that's, you know, it's monumental enough. You get a record season. God, if I was just him, though, I would just want to run up the scoreboard as long as I could. I just would want to make it so no one would ever get it, because it's so hard to think of having anyone here for 11, 12, 13, 14 years in the future. And it's also impossible to think anyone would be here for like 10 years and they're just ripping off 10 win seasons and passing, I mean, that way.
Most State fans have been dealing with it longer than 10 years, right? We should be the exhausted ones. We should all be retiring. Like, we've all dealt with it. We know what Dave's dealing with. Like, he gets a little bit more of it, but we've been dealing with it longer. So I get it.
He is so lucky we're bad at basketball.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'd get it.
Over under 200 yards of offense for the Pack.
Oh, over. Over. I think Brennan's going to do about 250 total. You know, some 250 or 190 and 60 kind of thing. So, yeah, I think we'll break that.
10.5 over under the number of times the broadcasters mention MJ.
Wow, 10.5. Does that include pregame? It has to, right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
As soon as they come on air.
Over.
Yeah,
over. Because too. You know what? If we do... If we're doing poorly out there, they're going to be, like, besmirching his name multiple times. They're going
to be panning to the sidelines where MJ is going to be in his hoodie.
And then if Brennan has, like, an incredible – he won't be on the sidelines. There's no way they bring him there. Have we brought any other redshirt quarterbacks? Actually, that's a good question. If someone could tell us
how – Jacoby drove himself. Everybody knows that story. That's what I'm
saying. He drove. Do you think MJ is going to do that?
Does he drive his truck one last time?
Does he still have it? Can he expense the miles?
Yeah.
But you know what I was going to say? It's like, then if Brennan Armstrong has a good game or a great game, let's just say he has a couple great plays, they're going to do that MJ who? So, yeah, 10.5. Someone's got to track this, though.
Yeah, I'm sure one of our listeners will do that. Does Peyton Wilson score another defensive TD?
No, I think it's going to be like it's either going to be Aiden White or it's going to be one of the defensive linemen.
I think Peyton gets a TD. I'm not going to say this game, but another one this season. And here's why: I think Dave wants to give him a TD. Like, I don't know if it'll be defensive. I think they might give him another one, like they did for was it Bradbury or one of the offensive? Yeah, right. I mean, I
they better be up a lot of points.
Yeah, I mean, let the run Carolina built out of the building and let Peyton score a TD. Oh my God, how awesome would that be?
I want you to imagine. I hope they call it. They'll call it LBU, and they'll have Brennan Armstrong, obviously the linebacker at quarterback. They'll have Peyton Wilson back there, and they'll have Jordan Poole. Yeah. And it'll, you know, right? The LBU triple option.
That was one of the next questions. How bad do we need Peyton Wilson and Jordan Poole in the backfield to block for Brennan Armstrong on a short yardage run? Very, very much.
Yeah, you know, that's actually really funny. Like, I've always wondered, why don't you put, like, a CJ Clark or someone, like, when he gets under center for that butt push, like, why do you not just get, like, two or three defensive linemen in there and just put all that mass behind that ass. Think.
Yeah. Is it wrong for me to think with the line playing better and the wide receivers rotations cut down that we see a better Brennan Armstrong?
Yes. No, it's not wrong.
Which leads us to the next question.
I'm saying it out loud because I figure I asked the question. I mean, don't. Okay. So that's my best Joe Pesci. If you go back, I know it's so silly, but if you, it's just, I feel like Brandon Armstrong looks very different when the offensive line is settled versus like the chaos of the Louisville game where it was like eight different rotations of it. And so I think that helps. But I think actually what's going to be more important is, do you think we're going to lean more on Raphael now after the Miami game?
Like, I hope not, healthy. Because we can't block. I mean, I get it, but yeah, as a running back, probably, but my offensive line still concerns me in that regard.
But if you go back and watch him in the UVA game, right? Like, even when we had line play issues, he was real positive when he was able to touch the ball, and then he got injured in that game. So I've actually been kind of thinking about it. Like, someone was like, oh, do you think we're going to see a lot of Keon Lassane and Mims again? And I was like, I don't think you're going to see that. Like, Mims seems like he's been really demoted. Maybe he had a touch or two. And
he's still getting the short yards carries. We just don't get many.
Yeah.
We're not driving the field, right?
We don't have that.
Touchdowns or explosive plays have been longer ones. Yeah. Very little short yardage playing. What Will is bourbon drinking?
Oh, Woodford Reserve. I said it wrong earlier. It's the malted. It's the malted. I think it's the malted rye. It's awesome.
What's your favorite bourbon under 20?
Under 20?
$20, yeah.
Man, I don't even know if that even exists anymore. George Dickel used to be. George Dickel was always my like value bet. It depends on where you are. Like if you go to Texas or somewhere like that, if you can get a bottle of Early Times, dollar per, you know, enjoyment, that one's great. And it's like $29 or something, like in Texas. W.L. Weller is always a great one. Same thing, it's another one that's kind of cheap. If you get a chance and you see it, one of my favorites is called New Riff. It's a great-looking bottle, and it tastes great, too. But it's one of those ones, like, if you're in Virginia here, it's, like, impossible to find it.
It's way better than UVA. Records are better, but Wake's play or UVA's play Tennessee, Maryland, and JMU out of conference. Wake,
I honestly think UVA is like it's so funny watching them still give a shit when they're 2-7 or whatever they are. Like, especially with Calandria. I mean, Muscat actually.
Great. I watched that game just for him because he's fun to watch. Nails.
I would do everything we can to get him out of there. I would also highly recommend you guys going to a UVA game and experiencing that game day atmosphere just for the commercial breaks where they try to guess like Taylor Swift songs. Like they have the players up there and they're like, do you know the Taylor Swift lyric? And they start reading it off. It's ridiculous. So if you're a football player, leave the grounds, come to NC State.
I'm sure Calandria listens.
He probably does. He looks like my half brother. And God, every time I would watch him, I'd be like, oh my God, that's my brother out there. So please come. I'll pay anything.
Last question. In terms of storylines, is this the most interesting NC State game in the last decade? It's pretty far up there. I'm sure y'all can think of a better one, and because people know I'm a terrible historian. But my God, how many games have we had against a rival with a week we had here towards the end of Dorn's coaching tenure? What it feels like, at least. And yeah, I don't know. It's got to be in the top three.
BENFINLEY. Ben Finley.
Well, that wasn't UNC. That wasn't an interesting storyline. It was after the game, it was a very interesting storyline. Like, yeah.
But you just lost to Ben Finley. Going into it, right? Like, we didn't even know. Like, did we even have a quarterback defined at that point? Let's see. Storyline wise. But the closest I can think of storyline wise is like Bailey Hockman at FSU.
But that's still.
Let me think here. There's got to be something more there.
How did Bailey Hockman ever get recruited to FSU? So weird.
You don't love the coach's son moxie that he displayed?
I'm going to say yes.
Under the right offense, he could have been awesome. Sorry, what did you say?
I'm going to say yes. I think this is the most interesting storyline we've had in a while.
It would, I think, actually, next week, man, I mean, it would have been even better if it could have been next week because it's the Virginia quarterback playing at Virginia Tech, the NC State soft-ass quarterback turned on the team and quit, and here we go. It's the linebacker at quarterback.
You're really trying to make that happen.
Well, I mean, Dave said it. It's like a linebacker out there. I just want the LBU triple option. I'm all about it now. You know what, son? You can tell I've had a big-ass pour of whiskey because I keep drinking the ice water.
Yeah, you just got ice going right now.
The whiskey will be back, but it's tasty.
Yeah, that glass
still
was full when we started, and it is empty. It's very empty right now.
Yeah, and all I had is a salad today, so it's about to be a
wild
night.
We should have done
this
podcast in about 30 more minutes, and then he'd really be ripe.
Emergency pod.
All right. Anything else about this game you want to talk about?
Do we think this might be like the final season of Dave Clawson? Do we think he's sticking around? Is there anyone else that we think should be on watch for not being around? It's like this is the best part of the season because it's like, do your teams fold or not?
I do love like coaching search season. I mean, it's super interesting who's going to get fired and who's moving along. Clawson, I think this year has set him back. Otherwise, he would be higher on the Michigan State list.
Yeah.
I don't think he's going anywhere. So, no.
What about Elko? Now that he's seen the non-Riley Leonard Day.
Their defense is still really good. And, you know, they won 9 games last year. I don't know what they're at this year. 6-3 probably. Playing Carolina this week. He's going to get
quarterback.
He's going to get attention.
Double digit dogs.
Mm-hmm.
Do we think Duke wins that game?
I don't know. Like, Duke's defense is really going to hamper Marion Hampton, who has been he's having a phenomenal year. But Duke's offense, what are they going to be able to do? They're just so limited. You know, they couldn't do anything but 3 plays against us.
Yeah, does Tez Walker get the Heisman this weekend?
I think Duke's defense is going to give them a hard time. So I don't know what it's going to be. I think the line's 14.5, and I think that's way too high.
Yeah. Better question. Does Drake May walk on senior night this weekend? Because this is their last home game, too.
I think Drake May is done. I think Mac Brown might be done.
That writing is on the wall, sir. Okay.
I mean,
so let's say Drake May leaves, Mac Brown gets shit canned when they go 7-5.
I think if Drake leaves this year, I think Mac might leave. I think there's a chance he might leave.
Nightmare fuel. Do they hire Jamie Chadwell?
I don't think so. I think he's too country bumpkin for them.
I don't know. Larry Fedora was quite the Texas bumpkin when you think about it.
Fair enough. Fair enough.
Mr. Red Bull.
Fair enough. I don't know. I don't think so. Mike Houston won that job for a while. He ain't getting after this year. But
is Manny Diaz getting fired?
They would give it to Chizik. Is what? Is who getting fired?
Is Manny Diaz getting fired?
Manny Diaz. He's the defense coordinator at Penn State. No.
Not Manny Diaz. Oh my God. That's how little I think of Mario Cristobal.
Mario Cristobal is not getting fired. No.
Yeah, but you know, in theory, they could lose like every one of these games, right? They're going to end. What? 6-6?
He's recruiting
six,
too well.
Possibly?
He'll gut his staffs again if he needs to. But like Van Dyke has been terrible. Their quarterback situation's terrible.
Do we really think the third staff will be better than the second or first for him?
No, they need to get some talent in there. And he is getting it, but like, I don't know, not fast enough. Which is crazy to me. I was talking to a buddy of mine and we were both talking about Miami. And somebody asked, like, how does FAU half decent? And you're like, well, they just have to recruit a small circle, right? They don't have to go anywhere. Like, Miami should be able to get their entire team from South Florida, and yet they still stink. I don't know. It's weird.
Yeah, I think the indictment of him is really you go to Oregon and then Dan Lanning seems to quickly surpass like what you were doing. So that'd be curious. What I was just going to ask is, do we think Tyler Van Dyke transfers, and do we think he transfers within the ACC?
Yes, he transfers. No, not in the ACC.
Okay.
I don't know where he's from, but I don't think he fits anywhere in the ACC right now.
I'm really hoping that we can complete the square and have Tyler Van Dyke transfer here, and then we get to play that video every single week of the year.
No chance. He's been terrible. He's in his head.
He's injured. He doesn't look right. Like,
yeah.
He needs some help. Okay, that was the last drunk question I can think of.
Yeah, no others. Double check and make sure we didn't miss anything. No, we're good.
Hold on. I need you to explain yourself. Do you think I can't hit the ball 300 yards, or you just don't think I can ever hit 72?
I mean, if the wind's strong enough,
the ball. I can tell you right now, I've hit it
off a mountain.
Oh my god, I've hit it 300. I've hit it 300 multiple times in my life. You're killing me. It's unfortunate that you've never seen me on a drive. I wish you could see me on a day where I'm driving the ball, like, because it's just you're just like, boy, you should be a scratch golfer, and then you see the rest of my game. That one drove me nuts today. I said, I'll show him. I was about to go to the driving range. And then I go, you know, I'm not going to go to the driving range because those balls, they're untrustworthy. And then I was like,
you're getting old, son. Taylor... doesn't fly as far as it used to.
I was about to say, I was like, how many of those TaylorMade stripes am I going to bust out at the driving range to prove him wrong?
Under. Take the under, folks. Take the under. Solid player. Not hitting a 300.
Oh, I'm going to heat the balls up in my pocket beforehand. I'm going to do everything I can.
All right. As always, thanks for listening. Hope the pack pulls one out. Winston-Salem. It's never boring being a Saint fan, as we all know. And as dust settles.
What do you got? Huh? What's the score? What's your guess?
So I've been doing the props for these first state games, right? I don't like to bet on the winners because it just makes me feel bad. So I picked the total under was 44.5, I think. I took the under. I took team totals under state 23.5 and Wake Forest 21.5. I think it's like a 21-14 game. That's too easy. Probably be like 22-12 or some stupid number because it's that stupid kind of game. It'll be close enough where I think Wake will be within like 8 at the end and we'll be like sweating it because this is what we do. We're like, oh, we're waiting for it to happen.
Yeah.
But I think state wins and it covers the 1.5. That's my prediction. But it's going to be a low scoring rock fight.
Yeah. I think it's going to be like a 31-14. Type game, actually.
Ooh, I would love that.
Until we hit 31.
You're in the Brennan Armstrong camp hard right now. You are
in. Yeah. I think the whiskey
added another touchdown.
Yeah, I just don't think Wake has really played a defense like this in a while. And the last time they did was FSU. And that's why I'm coming back to it. I just think they're going to get rattled really fast. And it's a senior day game. And I always say that the senior days give you really weird emotions. And so the first quarter with Brendan Armstrong, it's going to be beautiful.
So state senior day, they come out emotional, and that's always the excuse. Everybody else comes out with their effing pants on fire. And yeah, so
not this year. Every senior is going to be wearing a number 5 jersey this year for Brendan Armstrong. And and then we're going to burn I can't even remember what jersey number MJ was.
Seven. The only reason I know that is because of the replacements thing I put on Twitter, which is hilarious.
We watched that 2 weekends ago, and I was hilarious. Dying when you put that together. Because I turned to Wahid, and I was just like, he nailed it. He nailed it. Pain heals.
Yeah. Yep. Love it. All right, y'all. As always, thanks for listening. Support the pod. Jump in the pod chat. It has been on fire lately. It's been fun. There's always
Ed
some
from
good conversations.
LA, out Ed of from nowhere.
Ed from LA is in. Yeah, it's been going. It's been some good conversations. There's a lot of good stuff going on. But as always, thanks for listening. Go Pack.
Go Pack.
Oh, I clicked the button. There it goes.
No music?
I'm trying. It's not working. It's not working. My button's not working. All right. No music. See y'all.